An author's afternoon, a joint venture by Prabhakaratan Foundation, T2, Taj Bengal and Sri Cement Limited, with one of its another fabulous afternoon editions. It is my honor and privilege to welcome Rita Chowdhury, an award-winning Assamese poet and writer, a former associate professor of political science at Cotton University, Guwahati. Rita is currently the director of the National Book Trust. An important voice in contemporary Assamese literature, Rita has written 15 novels and poetry, a vivid picture of her strife-torn state. The critically acclaimed Chinatown Days, or Makam, is one of her best-known works. To be in conversation with her, we have Anjum Katyal, an author, translator of several books, and she has spent many years in editing, most notably as the chief editor for Seagull Books, Calcutta. To take this session forward, I would like to welcome both of them to start this session.
Thank you very much. Welcome to, can you hear me, everybody?
Yeah.
Welcome to Calcutta. And I've just spent the last week or so reading this really very, very absorbing book, and Chinatown Days. In Calcutta, many of us have got links to the tea gardens and the tea world, because Calcutta was traditionally a sort of place from which tea was sold, auctioned, and a lot of the agency houses were here. So reading about this aspect of tea garden life, the Chinese community, how ingrained they were there, and then how they were uprooted, was a very, very fascinating experience for me personally. But Rita, you, this is just your latest book. You have been a writer for since the age of 19. Rita's first book was at the age of 19, and her very first novel became an award-winning novel. She got recognition instantly. And you've been writing since then. And not just writing, but your life has gone through lots and lots of different phases, including political activism, and of course teaching of politics and political science. So one of the things that I found very interesting was the knowledge that you are a person who has spent your life in political science as a discipline, right? But being a writer is all about responding at a very human level. It's not so much the big picture and the abstract strategies of political science, but it's the ordinary human being whose life you write about. So can you talk a little bit about how one aspect of your life has sort of helped you or impacted or made you aware as a writer of this? Like you were talking to me about how people have always mattered to you, causes and justice. Maybe a little bit about how you came into, how you wrote your first book, what was the feeling behind that?
I don't know how to start. It was actually kind of accidental, or my destiny to be a writer. I don't know the beginning of the writer, how that the scene was created. I don't know anything about that, but my background or my experiences, or maybe I was inborn, I have that tendency to, I have a very protective nature. So I think my entire life is devoted to protecting people or everything are in distress or.
So you jump in when you see that something
I can't tolerate. Maybe there are a few things in my very important in my life. My father was in civil administration, but he has a special training of guerrilla warfare. And in 1971 war, I was class 3, and my father trained the Mukti Bahini people. This is a very different experience and at that age, because I saw all young boys from Dhaka University and all, they came to the Afghan Police Training Center to go on trainings, and I saw those people from their closed ranks, their devotion, or I have read their letters wrote to my father, like B and Sir. So that is a, and I went to Bangladesh, that is East Pakistan, that time during the war with my father. I saw a house with all the there's a fighting, and of there's all there's
bullet holes.
Yes, bullet holes. So that was my experience.
And this was when you were in class 3.
Yes.
So you were really young.
Yeah. Then time I had another experience. My sister, she was 1.5 years older than me, suddenly she died. I was not a good child, maybe. I was very mischievous, and she was very good. She was very, you know, very caring. She was the only person, I think, in this world who could understand me. I tortured her like anything. So suddenly she died, and my childhood ended there. I entered into a very new life called, let's call it the life of books, so that my understanding of her life, my perspective or whatever changed.
Yeah.
So
how old were you when this
I was 9 or 10, at the same time it happened. Then I saw, came the phase of the Assam movement.
Yeah.
In Assam movement, I was in college, and I took part. And as I think, because of this background, or because of because of somewhere, I want that I have learned that serviceable or whatever. Maybe after because of this, I become a frontliner. I'm not a leader, but I'm a frontliner. So I had to abscond for almost 1 year. So when I was hiding, that time suddenly one person gave me a book of insurgency, guerrilla warfare. So it was covered with a newspaper. And before reading the book, I saw an advertisement. There's a competition organized by Assam Sahitya Sabha. I took a competition of the manuscript. Subject was Assam movement. I thought
manuscript on the Assamese movement.
Assam movement.
Yeah, Assam.
Against the illegal immigrants.
Right.
I just thought for some, maybe because I was a voracious reader. And I can understand the Bangladeshi children's language also.
Yeah.
I read that when I was in class 6. I finished all these books. So then after 1 month, because I was going from one place to another, so after 1 month, again I saw this newspaper. They had extended it to another month. Then I decided, okay, I'll write a book. Then I selected some names, characters. Then I started with some dialogues. There was no structure of the novel. It was because I was, before that I didn't write any prose. So this is the beginning, and when I finished the book, I sent it to the secretary. After a few days, I was arrested. So I was put in a Guwahati police station, in lockup for 7 days, day and night they interrogated me. My father was also arrested. Then from there, Guwahati jail, from jail to Dibrugarh jail, I was transferred. And I fought for all these people inside, all this the lady prisoners especially. I saw how they were suffering, how they were deprived from the dues. So I fought there for these people also for 2.5 months. So I was forcefully transferred to Guwahati jail.
Even as a prisoner, you were causing.
Yeah, it was very interesting, but I can't waste my time because I don't have much time. So this is very interesting. That is, I was confined in a cell because I have started challenging everything. Why they are not getting this, getting that, or is that my right? Then in that period when I was in Dibrugarh, then it was announced and I got first prize. Then overnight, Rita was in jail. She wrote a novel, it become immediately, you know, very popular. And I, overnight I become a writer.
And then what brought you back into it after 10 years?
Yeah, then my husband, he was a co-activist. After the movement was over, the Assam Gana Parishad was formed, and he became a minister. I got married to a minister. It's a sudden change in my life. It's a sharp U-turn. From an activist, I become a wife of a minister. Means that is a different identity. Activism is a different identity. And minister's wife is a different identity. And people look at the minister's wife, all you know, how they look at the minister's wife. So it was a period of confusion. It was a period of, you know, suffering. For long 10 years, I didn't know what to do because there was no movement. I didn't have any identity. I was a teacher. I joined a lecturer. I thought that I should read, I should study, and I should create my own life. Then after 10 years, I decided that I have to go back to my people. What I want, because there is offer for me to join politics, but then I thought, no, it is not my place. I don't want this kind of, no.
So you felt that as a writer, you are closer to addressing the injustices that you saw and the stories that you want, than as a political person?
No, I was in the minister's colony, seeing everything from inside. What that journalist or other people, they saw politics, they don't know the inside story. Actually, what I saw as a wife of a minister, it was completely different from outsiders. And I was an activist, still I was an activist.
At heart.
I could not become a minister's wife.
Yeah.
So there was two person. One was the wife, say, from every close range, from the inside story, and a very critical eye, looking everything, criticizing, challenging. Or so then I realized that, no, I have to go back. I need that love that I got when I was an activist. So that is, then I thought that it is only one thing I have in my hand, and where I'm completely independent, that is my pen. So I decided to write again. It took time to, you know, first I could not write anything, very difficult. And my daughter was born after 9 years of, I was barren for 9 years, she was born. And when she was born, I got the meaning of life. Then after that, after 95, I started writing seriously. And after that, long 15 years, I only keep on writing. My took care of my children, my daughter and my son, teaching and writing.
So that became your main identity?
Yes.
To be the writer and looking after the children. Yeah. But you had also mentioned to me that almost all your books have had, you've told the stories of people who have been deprived or there's been a serious injustice done.
Yeah.
You've never moved away from that socio-political concerns that you had as an activist, as a fighter for people's rights.
Yes.
Right? So is that a sort of a common thread throughout all your writing?
Yes. Actually, it kind of a transformation. As an activist, my pen became my platform from where I was individually. I didn't have any team. I took up many social issues and I worked like Troy children, like the terrorism or insurgency. Any subject I took up and I
would write about that.
And wrote about that.
Yeah.
So it's a kind of, you know, that gave me with satisfaction that I. Finally, after long 15 years, I got that space that now actually people of Assam, they love me.
You had also mentioned that your inspiration, one of your inspirations was Asha Purnamedi.
Yeah, yes.
And I see some ways also similarities with Mahashweta Devi and other writers who've also sort of written about people who are at the edges of our society or the very downtrodden people.
Yeah.
But what was it about Asha Purna Devi that really drew your...
Yes. Asha Purna Devi, I don't think that there is any comparison to that lady. She is a great soul. From her writing, I have learned about human psychology. Actually, still, Asapuna Devi is not properly explored in her writing. Her every character, actually, the student of psychology should go through Asapuna Devi's novel, and they will find different kind of human psychology. And what I learned from, basically, I learned two things. One is that that's the love, the character. You cannot be partial. You can't be in favor of the protagonist. You can't. I must be neutral, and it should be start with a why. Why that person in that particular situation reacted like that? Suppose I am teacher of political science. I am a welfare minister. I am director of National Book Trust. In a particular situation, my reaction may be different from your reaction. So in when I depicting one character, then started with a question: what is the background of this particular behavior? So because of that, my characters become very true, and I have an antenna writer. Wherever I am talking with you, or wherever I am, but another eye is observing and recording things. And when I start writing, somewhere I get the supply of these informations.
So what is remarkable about the book is the sort of, I'd love it if you would comment on that, is the sort of constant moving back and forth between the big picture of the history that is being played out, which all of us have read about in our history books. You know, we have the dates, we know about the war, we know, and the smaller, not smaller is the wrong word, the sort of more focused picture of the ordinary people. So this, to me, comes straight from the activism in you. That, you know, but was that a conscious, as a writer, did you plot it like that, that we'll move, now I move back to the big picture, now to the small? How did you work out the novel? Did you think of it like that?
Every novel has its own, when I plan a novel, generally I have a structure in front of me. Not in every novel, generally we do it. So here, because I wanted to, that Aruna created a character, one way, maybe it's a kind of reflection of my own activism, but because what Aruna did here, actually I did.
Aruna is the character who writes this book.
I met those people. Not everything I have to make is a male character. And what that experience of Aruna is my experience. So I met those people who were arrested, who were deported, and whose families were separated. They were separated, and where their properties, urban properties, were auctioned as enemy property. It was a really very tragic part of our history. And what actually I want, that's why I told you that history, actually what we see, it's not the entire picture. Behind that there are so many things. And in democratic country also turns to an authoritarian country in time of war. And because of the UN has passed one,
Geneva Convention.
And India was one of the signatory in 1961, I think. The Geneva Convention Act was passed in India for non-combatant civilians who were stuck in time of war. But no one followed that. I met one lady called, her name is Linji, when my book was published. People did not want to tell about their life. And I met her. I came to know she was 6 years old. And her parents were, and she was in her grandmother's house when their family was arrested. And she ran to the train station, but by this time the train was left, she was left behind. She was 6 years old. And it's the responsibility of the government. Government did not take any action to that never care to think about the left behind. So for after a long 50 years, I met her. I sent her with her family and her grandchildren to China, and she finally met her parents, who are 90 years old, and they spoke in pure Assamese. They are living in a farmhouse where they used to live. That is not a farmhouse now. So this is, I think, one of my big work, but big satisfaction that I have done something good to some human being. So
you have something to show us, right? About you were going to show us.
Yeah, I want to show you because you will know. What they see, what I understand when it see. Because you have to help me when I say so. These are all deportees. This is the character of my novel. She is no more now. These are all deportees. They write in Assamese. He learned her name in Assamese. And this lady requested me to find her mother, but I could not find her. She was lost somewhere. These are all I met in Hong Kong. She is a new generation of deportees. He is an Indian Chinese living here in Assam. This is also one person who is living in Assam. She is the mother of one of deportees. She is from Bihar. So that she said that you will come back, don't worry. Her entire family was arrested. But when they came, they could not find their mother. Yeah.
So,
this person, his mother was Assamese teacher called Pramila Gokul. She was headmistress of an Assamese school. She went to China with her children and her husband. She died in China. She got Assamese there in China. They speak, is in 40, her son, speak in a pure Assamese. This lady is Siu, there's a character Siu. Her name is different, his husband wife. She is no more. You can see their features. We can't say that they are Chinese. They forget their language. They don't know anything about China. They have taken this Assam as their motherland. They call this a Janam Jaga. I want to show you. That you can read the novel, but these are the people who encouraged me or inspired me to write this book. Suddenly they were arrested. You can see now how they celebrate India Day, how they remember their Janam Jaga. Every Chinese wants to come back before they die to their place of birth, which they could not make.
They
live in silence. They don't come out. Because every time they come out, it is now that environment is not there. When there is a crisis, border crisis, people start looking at them. Kya hua? Border mein aisa ho raha hai? Kya ho raha hai? Still people look at them and ask this class for service
requests.
They feel so bad.
So this person is still living in Assam.
His brother was studying in agriculture. He was arrested. His entire family left behind. He was sent to Beijing University and he studied agriculture there and retired as a professor of Beijing University. He never came back to see his family. They could see him again. Yeah, his family is still in Assam. I could not meet him, but I heard it from him. He's a character in my novel. I think his name is Amen.
He became a radio announcer also.
Yes, right. Because he spoke pure Assamese, right. So he became Assamese newsreader there in China radio. Just a minute. I want to show you the how they celebrate. How they remember their motherland. All Chinese, you see.
And I think it's because of this that they were never accepted really in China. Chinese felt that
they are something else. They are new generation of deportees.
Bollywood cross is all about borders anyway, right? Actually, in Calcutta also we have such a robust Chinese community, and most of them are very Indianized in a lot of ways, you know. So it's not that unusual to see this kind of thing. We'll be taking questions, right?
So I consider them as our own people. They are not Chinese, they are Assamese Chinese, part of our greater Indian identity. So when I met them, I make a mission and I started researching on that and finally.
First of all, congratulations, very well written. You see, you started as an activist in the Assam movement. And the Assam movement itself was based on a degree of ethno-linguistic lines, right? Now, you captured very well the difficulties faced by the Chinese in that thing. But a lot of people in Assam, in fact, your movement was also very much for the Assamese people. And how about the large number of Bengalis, Marwaris, Muslims, Bangladeshis, who've also been there for a very, very long time. I mean, you know, and now with this National Register of Citizens, we have about 10 to 15 lakh people in the Barak Valley wouldn't know what to do. So how do you react as a, both as a person from political science, as a sensitive human being, and also somebody who's deeply engaged in the politics of Assam?
Actually, my reading started from Spoken Studies, what's the name? There's a detective novel, and it's about that book, I just forgot. That's a 100 day nights story, what's it in Bengali?
You're talking about the Arabian Nights.
Yes, Arabian Nights.
So,
yes,
in Bengali,
what are
the
names?
In Bengali, you have a version of
Arab Arab version. Arab version, yes. I started from that. And my childhood was actually based on the Sutta. And I had a big dream to come to Jamabugur land and to see that they were all living characters for me. And I was really young. When I come here, I feel that attachment. My daughter will now cry. It was my pet. Some guest came to our house, and my mother said, I'll take you to Calcutta, give it to us. I have nothing to offer to our guest. Please give it to us. And I gave it to interest to come to Calcutta, go to Jamalpur Lab, Deva Sahitya Koti. So this is, you know, my attachment. So I have to be very true at this age. And when Assam movement started, in different areas there were different kinds of sentiments. So in Upper Assam, generally where the railway stations are there, generally there is a concentration of Bengali people. And the situation of those areas, and in the Lower Assam, where the concentration of Bangladeshi Muslims, the situation is different. So that in the interim Assam movement, we can say that it was happened, you know, everywhere. So our experience was almost anti-Bengali, because there were Bengali schools and they were against the Assam movement, and they threatened me to, not they, I don't know who, but it was, I got one season of a letter to refrain from joining. That's a different issue. So I was young and I stopped reading Sukhtara. So I thought I should not. So because that is a kind of, they have big people, all the political people, whoever, they have created that thing. Oh, we didn't have any, because I had a transferable job, and I played the role of Chandarini, I played the role of the person, as I said, I forgot now, at a very young time, and I have played a role of Chandarini. My base was at Sanchaita, still. So suddenly that environment was created, and there was rioting, and then that time I don't know what was my feeling, because I didn't see any kind of discovery in my, didn't have, because I was absconding most of the time and I was in jail. But after the movement was over, and when I become a professor of political science, and I'm matured, you know, always finally you have, if you are a human being, finally you have to be a humanist. Then when I look back, I realize it, the sentiment that was created, it was a creation, it's a construction, I believe, a construction. And when there's a rioting or kind of this kind of events happens, bad things happens, being a wife of a politician, my experiences, my understanding as a professor of political science, I know that behind all these things, there is someone, you know, what we call is puppet. These are all puppets who are involved, engaged in this kind of rioting. Someone is, yes. Okay. That is my experience, that I have realized. But that is fact. People, the illiterate people living in villages, they don't understand things. If they are, suppose I went to one small village, there is a Nepali village in that movement. There are no young people. I asked why that's been, where does young boys gone? They said that no, then Rita Chowdhury is coming. They told us that she will come and she will cut all, kill all the Nepalese. So said I fled. Then said, do you know Rita Chowdhury? He said, no, I'm Rita Chowdhury. Do you feel that I can kill your people? Call your young boys. The day came, we had a meeting and it was over. So in time of movement, this kind of thing happens. And we should be very, very careful. Like my personal experience, and I wrote a book called Ei Homoi, Hei Homoi. There I tried to analyze this kind of thing. Not, I cannot cover everything, but finally I have become a humanist. I have my own sentiment. I respect my identity as a Homia. But finally, when you mature, you can understand this world, and especially when you enter into the outgoing phase, you have to come out from all these limitations and rise above this kind of boundaries created by politics. That's my understanding. I'm very sorry for all this what happened, but because of my personal experience, I know how people are instigated, how they that spread false informations. So like someone, there's a Manipuri boy in our place, someone informed him that Rita, someone killed Rita, Bengalis killed Rita. He was very angry. He came out with a dagger in his hand, stopped a bus, entered into the bus. So a Bengali, he identified one Bengali, just stabbed him. He ran, but he was saved. I was not attacked. I was fine. But it's a creation, it's a kind of rumor which create this kind of provocation. He was, that boy was also, Bengali boy was also innocent, and that person also, he loves me. So when he came to know that I was killed, I became furious. So these are actually the base level, people are always innocent. Someone plays this kind of games. And as a conscious people, we should be very, very careful. Still, these are issues are going on. So I don't believe in this kind of thing. I have translated again now when I stopped reading Suktara, but I am inspired by Subarnalata. See, this is a book which inspired and encouraged me to write. And I have translated one of my book to Bengali. I have translated is a Papi Nakhatran Golpo, published by some publisher there in Dhaka. It was released in Dhaka. I went there. So this is the kind of, you know, again coming back to my innocence, again came back to my that humanity that I translated that book. But it is about the ease. It is about the, you know, immaturity that all the politically motivated people, they misuse and they provoke and they create all these kind of nuisances.
Thank you very much. Just let me just do the word of thanks on behalf of Taj Bengal. My name is Manish. I've just come in here for just about a month and a half here. And this is my first author's afternoon. And I again got a little delayed, so apologies about that. But since the time I've come in, it's been so engrossing that I just completely lost the thought that, and I really felt it was my loss that I joined a little late. So thank you very much, everybody, for coming.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, everybody, once again.
Have a great day.